Hello everyone, I'm going to be live painting using airbrush ink. Put on some sounds. What I was listening to De Quincey Confessions of an English Opium Eater. Kieran, I'm live streaming on YouTube. Yeah. Yep. This is on the live stream. Fuck, what am I doing? Oh yeah, okay. Live now. Ha! And there's a delay. It's tricky. Significant delay.
Simple truth, though to satisfy the theories of medical men I ought to be ill, I never was better in my life than in the spring of 1812. And I hope sincerely that the quantity of claret caused for particular Madeira, which in all probability you, good reader, have taken, would be designed to take an out of 8 years' jury.
Alright, the delay is crazy. Live stream.
Ooh.
Wait for it. It takes like 15 seconds. Yeah, that's all. All compression. What? No one's watching! Oh, one person.
No, you. You're watching.
Alright, what was it? Painting. Totally forget. I'm not killing 8,000 people. That was live stream. Alright,
opium I have taken for 8 years, between 1804 and 1812. Hence, you may see again the danger of taking any medical advice from Anastasius. In divinity, for aught I know, or law, he may be a safe counsellor, but not in medicine. No, it is far better to consult Dr. Buchan, as I did, for I never forgot that worthy man's excellent suggestion, and I was particularly careful not to take above 25 ounces of laudanum. To this moderation and temperate use of the article, I may ascribe it, I suppose, that as yet at least, i.e. in 1812, I am ignorant and unsuspicious of the avenging terrors which opium has in store for those who abuse its lenity. At the same time, it must not be forgotten that hitherto I have been only a dilettante eater of opium. 8 years' practice, even, with a single precaution of allowing sufficient intervals between every indulgence, has not been sufficient to make opium necessary to me as an article of daily diet. But now comes a different era. Move on, if you please, reader, to 1813. In the summer of the year we have just quitted, I have suffered much in bodily health from distress of mind connected with a very melancholy event. This event being in no ways related to the subject now before me, further than through the bodily illness which it produced, I need not more particularly notice. Whether this illness of 1812 had any share in that of 1813, I know not. But so it was that in the latter year, I was attacked by a most appalling irritation of the stomach, in all respects the same as that which had caused me so much suffering in youth, and accompanied by a revival of all old dreams. This is the point of my narrative on which justification, the whole of what follows may be said to hinge. And here I find myself in a perplexing dilemma. Either, on the one hand, I must exhaust the reader's patience by such a detail of my malady, or of my struggles with it, as might suffice to establish the fact of my inability to wrestle any longer with irritation and constant suffering. Or, on the other hand, by passing lightly over this critical part of my story, I must forego the benefit of a stronger impression left on the mind of the reader, and must lay myself open to the misconstruction of having slipped by the easy and gradual steps of self-indulging persons from the first to the final stage of opium eating, a misconstruction to which there will be a lurking predisposition in most readers from my previous acknowledgements. This is the dilemma, the first horn of which would be sufficient to toss and gall any column of patient readers, though drawn up 16 deep and constantly relieved by fresh men. Consequently, that is not to be thought of. It remains, then, that I postulate so much as is necessary for my purpose. And let me take as full credit for what I postulate as if I had demonstrated it, good reader, at the expense of your patience and my own. Be not so ungenerous as to let me suffer in your good opinion through my own forbearance and regard for your comfort. No, believe all that I ask of you, viz., that I could resist no longer. Believe it liberally and as an act of grace, or else in mere prudence. For if not, then in the next edition of my opium confessions, revised and enlarged, I will make you believe and tremble. And a first on the year, by mere dint of pandiculation, I will terrify all readers of mine from ever questioning any postulate I shall think fit to make. This, then, let me repeat, I postulate. But at the time I began to take opium daily, I could not have done otherwise. Whether, indeed, afterwards I might not have succeeded in breaking off the habit, even when it seemed to me that all efforts would be unavailing, and whether many of the innumerable efforts which I did make might not have been carried much further, and my gradual reconquests of ground lost might not have been followed up much more energetically. These are questions which I must decline. Perhaps I might make out a case of palliation, but shall I speak ingenuously? I confess it as a besetting infirmity of mine that I am too much of an eudaimonist. I hanker too much after a state of happiness, both for myself and others. I cannot face misery, whether my own or not, with an eye of sufficient firmness. and I'm little capable of encountering present pain for the sake of any reversionary benefit. On some other matters, I can agree with the gentleman in the cotton trade at Manchester in affecting the Stoic philosophy, but not in this. Here I take the liberty of an eclectic philosopher, and I look out for some courteous and considerate sect that will condescend more to the infernal condition of an opium eater. But our sweet men, as Chaucer says, to give absolution, and will show some conscience in the penances they inflict, and the efforts of abstinence they exact from poor sinners like myself. An inhuman moralist I can no more endure in my nervous state than opium that has not been boiled. At any rate, he who summons me to send out a large freight of self-denial and mortification upon any cruising voyage of moral improvement must make it clear to my understanding that the concern is a hopeful one. At my time of life, 36 years of age, it cannot be supposed that I have much energy to spare. In fact, I find it all little enough for the intellectual labours I have on my hands, and therefore let no man expect to smite me by a few hard words into embarking any part of it upon desperate adventures of morality. Whether desperate or not, however, the issue of the struggle in 1813 was what I have mentioned, and from this date, the reader is to consider me as a regular and confirmed opium eater. Of whom to ask whether on any particular day he had or had not taken opium would be to ask whether his lungs had performed respiration or the heart fulfilled its functions. You understand now, reader, what I am, and you are by this time aware that no old gentleman with a snow-white beard will have any chance of persuading me to surrender the little golden receptacle of the pernicious drug. No, I give notice to all, whether moralists or surgeons, that whatever be their pretensions and their skill in their respective lines of practice, they must not hope for any countenance from me. They should think to begin by any savage proposition for a Lent or a Ramadan of abstinence from opium. This then being all fully understood between us, we shall in future sail before the wind. Now then, reader, from 1813, where all this time we have been sitting down and loitering, rise up, if you please,